Hello, IMS. My name is Olivia. I'm the managing editor of Mixmag Asia. We are unique because we publish almost exclusively about Asia, and we cover 8 territories officially. Something that I have learned is that every single one of these territories is completely different from the one right next to it. Their music industries operate in a completely different way than the country and the city right beside them. What you're going to learn today is a little bit about these nuances, about these music scenes, and how to tap into them, but most importantly, who these guys are. These guys are the rising stars of Asia-Pacific, and they are important because they show you how it can be done. They show they're an inspiration to local artists on how to break out of Asia, and for other people, how to break into Asia. We've also got 2 translators on here on the board as well because we have some limited English abilities. But I will let these guys introduce themselves and just let everyone know who you are, what's your name, what you play, and also in one line, why you think you're sitting up here, why you've been asked to sit on this panel, and what's the special thing that you've done to get yourself here. Start with you, Myrne.
Hello, guys. My name is Myrne Manfred Lim. I'm 21 years old. I mostly play and produce a form of trap, future bass, or mostly bass music. A year ago, I signed my first EP to Matt Decent. And I think I'm here because I just simply prioritize the right things from a young age.
Hello, 大家好. 我叫周成龙，然后 DJ 名叫 DJ Air， 然后我是 Mist 的音乐总监，然后我擅长的风格是 Progressive House and EDM 还有 Trap 这一些吧。谢谢大家。
I'm the translation, so I'm not a DJ, first of all. DJ L, it's a music director of the Mist, and he's playing a progressive house and also EDM and trap.
Hi, everybody. My name is Kaku. I was born in Tokyo, but most of my life I grew up in the U.S. And I moved out here about 6 years ago, and I play everything from big room to bass music, hip-hop. I'm pretty open format, producing a lot. More big room nowadays, but yeah.
Hello, I'm Minii from the Seoul, and I usually play the house music and techno, and it's a bit of underground music. And here I am. And it's good to hear this. Thanks.
Hello, everybody. My name is Chace, and I'm signed with Brown Family. And basically, I play kind of a diverse set. And then I think why I'm here, because like I achieved, I think, a lot of things in Holland. Like we did this first Holland tour this summer, and I'm just very honored to be here. Thanks.
Chace, I'm gonna continue going with you here because I think it's really interesting. Tell everybody how old you are.
I'm 17.
He's 17 years old, and give us a little bit of a background on how you got to where you are and where you spent the summer and who you've just collaborated with, because I think your story is very inspiring to other artists that are young and trying to make it with make it in the Western world of electronic music.
Right, so the story about me is I basically have a musical family, and then my dad has a band, and I used to tour with him around China since I was 2. And I started off as a drummer, so I basically born with that, if I may. And then, so I learned first doing a cappella music since I was 9. That's how I started, and I did that for 4 years. And then I just got into this electronic music thing. It started off with David Guetta and Tiesto, and then I thought I'd just give it a try, and then I'm here, yeah.
How did you get connected with Yellow Claw? How did that relationship come about?
It's a very funny story. So my manager is a Dutch guy. And then his company throwed him and a project. It's like an exchange project from between Holland to China. And then he just got here in Beijing, and then we just randomly met in a club in Shanghai. So we got I think I was a DJ that night, and I said, one of the track is my own production, so he caught that. So he came to me later. So you got anything we can work with? So maybe, yeah, that's how everything got started. And then he is actually the brother of the one of the DJ from the party squad. And then that's how he just knows everybody in this industry. He's been out there in the field for a while. And then he sent I first finished my EP, and then he sent this EP to Jim from Yellow Claw, and then just started.
And you just left China for the first time in your life. Tell us a little bit about that and where you went.
I'm sorry?
Tell us about that and where you went.
Yeah, so I came to Holland this summer for 2 months, and then the first it's like, because the label, Brown Family, is based in Amsterdam. So basically, I was there for the work, but also for some shows. So I played a lot of club gigs and also festivals and also Tomorrowland. That's basically a dream to me. So yeah, and I also did a lot of sessions, studio collaborations with a lot of local DJs. Yeah.
Myrne, I'm going to come over to you because you have a little bit of a similar story in terms of connecting with a big label. So give us a little bit of a background on your path to success.
Right. Admittedly, I took a more independent route. I'm based in Singapore, so in the recent 5 years, there hasn't been a huge, you know, electronic boom or even, you know, a deep set culture that you can find in Singapore, not like Chicago's house or Atlanta's rap. In Singapore, it's very different. It's a melting pot of cultures, and there isn't a really deep electronic scene. So when I was about 17 or 16, just interested in music in general, a lot of the early house music, early techno house, and the early kinds of progressive house, like with Joris Voren, Eric Prydz, Dubfire, really left a lasting impression on me. And I just tried to go about arranging and producing. But I was getting nowhere because in Singapore, there isn't like, you know, schools or paths for young people to just pick up producing or get taught. So what I would do was just to lock myself away for hours at a time on YouTube, just learning every bit I can. And 2 years ago, I had to serve in the army in Singapore. And during that time, I had quite a bit of spare time, ironically, to experiment with just producing. I didn't have any record obligations. I didn't have to, you know, remix things for people, or I didn't have to put out, you know, minimum quantities of songs a year. So I would just do a lot of bootlegs and remixes. And one of them was a remix of Skrillex and Diplo's song "To You," featuring Aluna George. So I uploaded it on SoundCloud, just left it there to simmer, and after a few months, it didn't really pick up, but I got an email from Paul Devereaux of Matt Deason saying, hey, this is really cool, do you have any more demos? And that was just what started my path to dance music.
So for the both of you, do you think that it would be boiled down to luck, hard work, talent, or who you know in terms of getting picked up by record labels? Chase, you
all right. I think I'm pretty honest about this because I've always been doing what I do. That's music. I've been doing this for a long time, and then so I just believe that I just need to keep on doing this, and then the things will just happen. Because that did not just happen for no reasons. I just randomly met a Dutch guy in Shanghai who's doing a project exchange project between Shanghai and Holland. Like, I believe those things, but I think that's something that I should say is luck. But I think without the hard working, there's never a good chance. The luck will never come to you.
Okay. Myrne, how about you?
Yeah, I definitely have to agree. I think luck plays a huge role, not just industry luck. I think once I took a sociology class on demographic luck, the concept of being born in the right place in the world, speaking the right language, having the right color of hair and eyes play a big role in someone's success. So, you know, being born in Asia, it's not a typical dance music hub. So you have to work against the odds. And as a result, you have to put in a lot of more hard work and passion. I think passion plays a huge role in it.
So I think the artists that we have on the panel, it's a really good diversity here because everybody got to where they are for very various reasons that are different from one another. Kaku, your story is completely different. So if you want to talk about your path to success.
Yeah, so I grew up in the States, like I said earlier, and I was just throwing my own parties, you know, in college and, you know, just like playing what I wanted to play. And after college, I decided to move to Asia, actually not for music. I was, you know, I just found a good job out in Taiwan and I just started that. But I realized when I was going out in the clubs and it just, I wasn't like hearing anything that I liked. So I just kind of gave a mixtape to a club and they liked what they heard. And I just started, you know, playing, I guess like at that time, like Big Room was pretty fresh, you know? So I was playing, you know, just like main room stuff and just really caught on. So, you know, I guess like I just started like locally in the club scene and then I went to Taiwan and kind of like built my fan base over there locally. And then started just touring Asia and I'm more of like a traditional DJ, like, you know, Myrne and Chace, like I love their music, but I was more going towards like what DJ AM did because that's kind of like the generation that I grew up in, like learning how to DJ. So what I realize now is just being a resident DJ, it's not enough anymore. You kind of have to create your own music or your own edits, and that's, you know, where I am at right now. You know, like I think I've been producing for over, almost like 2 years now, but it's because I had to. You know, it's like you just couldn't be like a good DJ anymore, just only a good DJ anymore. You had to make your own music. So that's kind of, I guess, the path. Yeah.
So transitioning from DJing into producing, do you find that producing is really what got your name out there? Did it happen right around the same time?
No, because I haven't released anything yet. But basically for me, it was the performance. I feel like, you know, I'm like, I don't know, I guess I'm a music nerd. You know, I'm really always on SoundCloud looking for like the newest music. So that's never changed. And that's why I feel like I'm a little bit different than a lot of the artists coming out of Asia. Just being that I grew up in the States and just have like a, I guess like a different knowledge of music. You know, like I heard Myrne's music like probably like way before a lot of the people have, you know? So it's kind of cool to be on this panel with all these guys right now. So.
Minii, your story is a little bit different. Yeah, if you want to just talk about your path to success and if you've had anyone advise you along the way.
When I started from the 18 years old, and then I released the two single album from my own. It's like a similar label or the crew. It's like named the Alter Ego. And from now, I used to play that cake shop and then pistol, and then they support me, and just pushing up to how to make underground music, how to figure out to underground music and soul. So here I am, I think.
So as someone, you're definitely one of the more local artists on this panel, as in being very local. Is it important, do you think, to have someone to advise you and help you?
Yeah, it's my crew Constance is named Junan from the Glancheck and Apache and Shinseha, and they are always advise me like how to figure out to the underground music and soul. So and then in the next to me is BNL agency and Mixmag and Kick Shop. What else? Yes.
And finally, DJ L, do you want to talk about a little bit what you do here in Shanghai?
现在我在上海主要在 Mix 的工作，然后也会在国外跑一些演出，然后在家里会做一些音乐，主要是在上海做这些。 然后我进入这一行嘛，我家庭也没有很好的，我家里没有音乐人，也没有做音乐的，然后反正走到今天也付出了很多吧，因为我很喜欢音乐，很喜欢这一行，而且在这期间也付出很多。
DJL is the music director of the Miss like 3 years ago, so he was having a competition with a big branch of the good DJs in China, and it's not easy for him to have this position and grow so big. And he said he doesn't have a music background, not from the family. Also, he doesn't have a record label to sign him, and he doesn't have anyone to help him. But how can he make to this panel? Or in nowadays, he just because he loves music and he doesn't want to give up, and he just trying and keep trying.
Okay, I want to talk a little bit about the challenges that are present both in your territories and your personal challenges. I think that I feel very strongly about Asia being such a big, 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 vast continent. There's over 4 billion people in Asia. That's more than double what you have in North America and in Europe. So statistically, this region should be rife with talent. So where are all the DJs that are getting booked in headlining spots in North America and Europe? How come there are so few Asian artists on those that are being billed? So what do you think are some of the challenges that are keeping Asian artists from getting out there, from getting exposure, from networking, from breaking out of their countries? Kaku, if you want to answer that one first.
Well, at least in my experiences, I feel like, I don't know, I guess I have to be honest. I feel like in Asia, a lot of the artists want to make money here, right? And so it's hard to be in like a region where, you know, like the art, like foreign artists want to come here, they want to perform, they want to make money. But it's hard for us to climb out and like, let's say perform in Europe or the US, you know? And I see that as a big challenge, you know? And this summer, I finally got a residency in Ibiza, so I was there for 2 months and I was able to kind of like observe the scene, you know? And yeah, I mean, there are no Asian DJs out there. And so I was probably like the first one, you know? And so I think this perception just has to change. I mean, there is talent out here in Asia. You know, I mean, obviously we're all sitting up here for a reason. And I think the foreign, you know, I guess like foreign labels have to just, I guess, look deeply into Asia, you know, invest a little more time for the artist development and stuff like that, you know?
Is there anything that you think the artists should be doing more of to get their name out there? So
I think another problem that we had in Asia is that it took us a little bit like longer to learn like how to do the marketing side of things, you know. And obviously, like Instagram, Facebook, all this stuff, it takes time to learn. And I think like there has been improvements, I think, the past few years, and myself included. Like I didn't know how to like properly promote myself online, you know, and still learning how to do it, but I think because the regions in Asia are so different, you know, like you go from Taiwan to China, China to Singapore. I mean, it's totally different countries. So how do you market it, like market yourself in these different Asias throughout Asia? So that's, I think, is a big challenge as well. But I think music is, like an international language, you know? So if it's good music, it's good music. And I think slowly we're all coming together now.
Chace, what do you think? I'm sure that you're surrounded by artists in Asia who have watched you get to where you are right now. And I'm sure that you know a lot of people that are very well talented but not getting the exposure that they deserve. Why do you think that they're not? What are the obstacles there?
I think because I'm based in China and I'm local. And then this major problem we have, which I think everybody knows, is the VPN problem. So we have this thing that, which Twitter, Instagram, and everything, SoundCloud, is all blocked. So technically, there's no way, or VPN, but for normal people, there's no way for you just to reach out. So there are like two separate worlds right there. It's like China and the rest. This is really messed up. If you wanna release a track, then you need two plans. One internationally, one local. So, yeah, but I know a lot of producers that really works really hard, and then they sometimes they just release stuff
just like that. They just upload it and then ask some of their friends to like repost it. And then and just it. Then they just wait there for something to happen. But I think it's like, it's the same as how bad you want it. So as long as you really want it to hit, you are always gonna reach the right audience. This is what I think, because I've been doing this for a while, and then at first I did this single called You. It's like a typical progressive house EDM track, and then I also just released it in a certain platform. And like back then, it's not like a big of a deal. I just released it, and then how do I say? I just asked for everybody to repost it, and then this guy from this app saw the heard the music, and then they want to put it on the chart, and then like good things happened. They went on the first place on the chart, and they just did a free music video for us, and then a lot of like big collaborations came. Like we did this collaboration with Momo Wu Mochou. She's like a very famous singer in China. So what I'm trying to say is, as long as you want it bad, as long as you want it bad and you keep working on what you have to work on, then it's eventually going to happen.
But is there any like barriers or any hurdles that you've had to sort of overcome, any obstacles that you feel that are very much related to China besides the firewall, anything personally as well?
Yep, so my story was, I was preparing for Shanghai Conservatory of Music for 8 years. So my hometown is like 3 hours drive from here. So back and forth, we drive here for 8 years, once a week. So how do I say, I've known Shanghai for a long time. And then, so I moved to Shanghai last year to prepare for the college, especially for the college. But then I got into the clubs, because I've been producing dance tracks before I moved to Shanghai. And then I'm just very interested in this industry, because I love the energy, I love how people recognizing you in the crowd. So yeah, the only barrier for me was to communicate with my parents, actually. Because they have no idea what this industry is. They just know, okay, there's a festival going on there, everybody, the young kids are just there. But it's very hard for me to explain what this industry is. How do I say? Because like everybody's path in China is kind of set. It's like different for everybody, but it's kind of similar. So you go to high school, you go to college, but that college is not like what you're looking for. You didn't get what your interest in the major. So sometimes the college thing is just one, like 4 extra years for most of the people. So I'm very lucky to have talked it out to my parents. Yeah.
Minnie, how about you? What's your experience with overcoming cultural barriers and regional barriers and personal obstacles that you had to overcome?
I focus on the music in the 18 years old, maybe. But it's like my parents don't like to do the music. So he's hit me up to my head. But I don't care about, I don't care that. Cause like I love music, and then I want to be a worldwide artist, and I see the Justice and then Brondinsky, and I see it, and then I run to their culture and their music. And then when I start this, this from now, I show the my music it's the break language barriers, but I just show my character. So yeah, stay tuned.
DJL. What are some of the barriers that you've had to overcome, the most difficult things that you've had to do to get to where you are today?
Yes. We think in China market, the most difficult things for us is our culture for that one, because we are in a very difficult industry. It's kind of the financing and the arts to combine together. So we are perform the artists in the club, but unfortunately in our culture, it's like distance create the value, but we are not from other country. We don't speak other language, and we are the same as everybody. So the people's not accepting us as accepting of foreigners. That's the most difficult things for us to go to overcome. Doesn't matter how much things we go to pay for, how much work we want to pay for, we'll never be like as good as the foreign DJs. That's the most difficult things for us as a Chinese, like totally 100% Chinese DJ.
So what's the balance in China between foreigners and expats? Do you feel like the music industry here is dominated by expats, or is it really much run by locals?
In China, it's very funny. Like, if we are the local DJs, if like Christmas Eve, Christmas, New Year Eve, this kind of the big holidays, or Friday or Saturday, if you want to put a big party, we local DJ will never be the main DJ. We always be warm up DJ, yes. Resident DJ, yes. But if you want to have a big party, we will never be. So expat. Not local DJ for the big party.
So what kinds of things do local DJs have to do to kind of get recognized, or how can they build relationships so they can get booked at these bigger parties and bigger clubs?
We do have some very famous Chinese DJ before, but if we think about it, they're all from Hong Kong, like none of them from China. So I think what can we do to make ourselves like becoming like fair as the international DJ, as the other like Korean or Japanese DJ? We just want the people to accept us. We also can be a good DJ, not just for a work, like doing the engineering every day. We can be very, very good DJ as well. So we just want our people to accept that we Chinese people, we can do art.
Minnie, what about in Korea? Do you think that the music scene there is very much dominated by expats or by locals?
Most Korean play this area. It's because many foreigners in Seoul, but they are more has talent, and Korean audience like the Korean guys, I think, as DJ or the artist. So, yes.
Myrne, what's the Singapore scene like? Is it locals or is it expats, or is it a good blend of both?
I think it's definitely a healthy blend of both. Singapore prides itself in being very open to trade to expats. I think the current population of Singapore, half of it is for expats, like exactly half. I think most of the barriers everyone has mentioned boil down to really just culture. How culture is consumed and what the prevailing, you know, mindsets are at the time. Like, for example, in Asia, we don't have this sense of, you know, introspection when it comes to culture, when it comes to consuming pop culture. We always take heat from the West. So, and because that's already in place, if you have a language barrier, like my family speaks Chinese, so if you have a language barrier, you're already wiping out half the global market. So that for many, you know, native language-speaking countries like Japan, Korea, it's even harder for them to break into the West. But if you live in a metropolis like, you know, I dare say Jakarta, Singapore, or even Shanghai, you get exposed to different types of cultures, and that definitely gives you an edge. Also because the cultures in the West pale very drastically to the East. For example, there's a heavy emphasis on drinking and partying in the media, right? Not to say that Asians don't do that at all. It's just not as televised, as pushed as in the West. And, you know, just because of this conservative nature of Asian culture, that also puts us behind in the entertainment scene. Or it just restricts your audience to that of locals. I'd say Singapore has a good balance due to the people coming in and out all the time. Like, one of the biggest club nights in Singapore is helmed by a local DJ. We still value people who are born and raised here. We give them an adequate stage to showcase your talent. But if you really want to go to the West to expand your markets, you really have to start selling a unique brand that not everyone else in the West already has, but with a touch of Asian flavor, I feel.
Give me some examples on what you think that this unique brand could be. What could these regional artists be doing to sort of add a little flavor of their own to it?
Right. That's a tough question. As for local acts that have made it to the U.S., it's few and far between, definitely. It's definitely on the rise, with people like Chace, Kaku. I'd say in Los Angeles itself, right, there's a whole new scene of Korean rap, right, or even Asian rap, like Keith Ape, Dumbfounded. They're all united just because of their culture, right? They're all Asians, even though born in America. And I think that's just important for minorities to just band together and to sell a very unique brand of music that not anyone else can replicate.
Coming back to language barriers, Minii, you want me to wait here? DJ, I'll start with you. Is language barrier a problem for you? Is that something that you feel it's very difficult to tap into the West or communicate with people from the West?
Yes, definitely English is a big problem for DJO. Just right now, he does want to speak to everybody, but he can't, so he has to use the female voice to go to speak for him, which is funny. And yeah, English is a big problem for him. He loses a lot of chances because of the languages, because right nowadays, many people sending him the email to invite him to go to Ibiza. Like last year, we two go to Ibiza as the first Chinese DJ, got paid, and also go to space to perform with the big acts in the golden time. It's the first time in the history. That's what space told me. But we supposed to do it before, but because he doesn't know how to reply the message, doesn't understand the language, so lose a lot of chance, like Ikro in Miami and in a lot of space. But now it's okay because I would do that for him, but he will find a girlfriend very soon and to go to, I mean like English girlfriend, so he can lean on himself.
So are you acting as his manager?
Yes, I'm his manager. Hi everybody, I'm Rachel, the market manager of Sino Group.
So do you think that Asia is lacking in management agencies that help local artists? Do you think Asia is lacking in management that could help local artists and sort of guide them and advise them on
yes,
what to do and respond to emails for them?
Yes, it's a brand new industry in China. We do have a lot of singers. We're very, very good for singers because China is a big KTV culture country. So a lot of singers going on. For DJ manager, I think like 100% pure DJ DNA, and DJL is the first one, and I'm the first manager as well. So we don't know what we can get tomorrow, but we're trying our best on today, yeah, to see what we can get.
Minii, what's your experience with the language barriers? Is that something that's a problem for you? If you have any ideas on how to fix it?
I think it's not. It's like I'm living in Itaewon. It's like many foreigners in the city in Seoul. So I just speak the English, the beats, something, but I can speak very well. But I need more learning English. That's more the perfect to me.
Chace, you are born and raised in China.
Yep.
But your English is great. How did you get to where you are? What's your advice for these guys? How can they and other regional artists learn from you?
Well, I didn't take that much time studying instead of watching tons of movies and dramas. So yeah, that's how I made my way out. I don't know if that's a good suggestion, but that's what happened.
Okay. Do any of you guys have managers or anyone that helps advise your career or connect you with people in the West, reach out to artists? No? Who helped you guys build your relationships? How did you actually first reach out with or connect with Mad Decent?
Back then, I didn't have a manager.
Okay.
So I wasn't educated on how to, you know, respond to an A&R email or how to be professional. But yeah, those are things you pick up. But right now, I do have a manager. He's from the UK. That really makes lots of just business partnerships a lot easier because of his connections. I think that's a relatively untapped market here in Asia. Mainly because of the language barrier, right? There isn't a writ light or an agency just for Asian talents as of yet. So it's a very large, new, and huge market.
Kaku, you have just been picked up by an agency that is just starting to take form. You want to tell us what that's
about?
Yeah,
sure. So actually, Myrne and I are under the same agency now. We're both under Super Modified. And actually, our group is called East Collective. So they had this idea of basically just getting some of the best regional talents together and basically like help each other, sort of, you know? And so actually, to answer your question earlier, I've never had a manager throughout my career. And it's honestly because I'm from, you know, I live in Taipei, and it is a smaller market in comparison to a lot of the other Asian countries. And honestly, I spoke English better than pretty much like everybody that could represent me. And so I just built my career on just every city I went to, I just networked on my own and trying to secure future gigs, you know, and then getting to know a lot of the artists in the region and helping each other out, you know, like DJ trades or whatever it may be. And slowly kind of built my brand that way, you know. And it's funny that East Collective is basically like what I've been doing for the past like 3-4 years. And, it's, you know, we're all coming together now. And Rob Harker and Super Modified is really investing a lot of time, Hugo as well, and investing a lot of time into this project. And we have a party coming up this Friday at Mint, so it's kind of our first like coming out party, I say. So Myrne and I are both performing. So it's really exciting times ahead, you know. Been doing this for, wow, like almost 10 years now, in Asia for, I say, like 5 years now. And really, I've seen like a huge change the past 2 years. So really excited for the times ahead, yeah.
Chace, do you think that there is anything that the music industry in the West could be doing to make it easier for Asian artists to break out of here? Is there anything that they could be investing or doing to help these local artists?
Well, I think we hit the jackpot, because I think this is exactly the right time where everybody is looking at China. And then I'm very honored to sign with the international label under Yellow Claw. It's got Brown Family, and I'm sorry, but what was the question again?
Is there anything that you think that the Western music industry can be doing to help regional artists,
right,
and to help Asia progress and connect with the West? How to bridge the gap between the two?
Right, I think that is more like to every artist and DJ, actually. It's not like which nationality or which country are from. It's more like keeping your things unique and make a brand out of it. So, yeah, if you look at me, I'm this blonde Asian kid. And then, and that's it, actually. If you're just purely looking at me, just being unique, that's the thing, I think.
What about social media platforms that are the strong platforms in each of your countries? Let's start with Singapore. What are the main social media platforms that artists are using to connect with each other and abroad?
For us, I mean, as Asian, as Singaporeans, it's Instagram. because I think Singaporeans are a bit more artsy, more open to creative forms of sharing, not just maybe like a long page of text on Facebook or being creative on Twitter. So I think Instagram's one of the biggest ones for Singapore.
Is there any that are just native to Singapore that people use, or?
No, I don't think so. We don't have any local social media platforms, unlike I think China. Yeah.
Yeah, DJL, how about you? What do you do about this great firewall of China? How do you get around that?
We're trying to also have the Facebook account block, Instagram block. So we only have WeChat at this moment, and also have our website. And everything we have to use the VPN, sometimes it's very frustrated. So, but it's one thing is very good, like in China, we have a very big population, and people and the world's distance only have 20 centimeters, and that's by WeChat. So WeChat is the main tools of how we go to post everything at the moment.
So if managers or agents from Europe or North America were trying to tap into China and find artists and producers, is WeChat where they should be looking?
Definitely. Everybody have the WeChat right now. I think the manager and outside of China, even in Spain, whatever, they're using WeChat as well.
What's the SoundCloud usage out here like? Is that something that you guys actively use, put music on SoundCloud?
Yes, we do use SoundCloud, and then we have to use the VPN as well.
Okay. Are there a lot of local artists that are finding ways around the firewall? Or is everyone just sort of ignoring these banned social media platforms and using things like WeChat?
I think the artists that love the music, like DJL, we do have the Facebook, we have the Instagram, and then we have the SoundCloud, we have everything like the international we want. But I would say we spend more time than the other countries' artists, because probably they can go on like straight away, and then we have to wait, you know, offline and get online again. That's very frustrating. So, but no choice. This is how it is. So we have to take it.
Kaku, what's the social media landscape like in Taiwan?
Well, in Taiwan, it's still predominantly Facebook. I say Instagram is just as popular now. But because I tour all around Asia, it's kind of like different wherever I go. Like in China, I recently found out that I had to make a Weibo, so I made one recently. And WeChat, I've been on it for like a year now. So it ranges, you know, like, but yeah, in Taiwan, mostly Facebook, Instagram works. Snapchat, slowly catching on a little bit, yeah.
Minnie, how about in Korea? What's the social media landscape like?
Korea is, internet is really fast, and Facebook and Instagram, and it's comfortable to us, and so, and SoundCloud too, but it has no Spotify. So, but it's like a original, it's a useful Spotify. So, but it's like we catch the trend really fast, because we, it's like important to like, looks like, what is it? So we just like a trend to catch, and like these days, like, vape something, but yeah, so it is.
What Minnie's trying to say is that South Korea has one of the fastest internets in the world, and the way that they absorb trend and throw it away and absorb another one. It's just a constant circulation of absorbing, throwing it away, absorbing. But then it's coming back. You know, the trends are also rotating in a way that it's a circulation of it. But Koreans tend to have an interval of, what, a year, 2 years, and a sudden trend change of fashion, of music, of even human behavior between Koreans. So I think that's what Minnie was trying to say. Yeah.
Chace, what are some of, you're just starting to grow your social media audience. It seems like you have a very big, your name is out there from productions and collaborations on SoundCloud, but it seems like you're just starting to build your Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. What are some of the strategies that you utilize to build your and grow your audience on social media?
So it's very funny if you're looking at the
the two worlds that I talked about. So for Twitter in China, you have Weibo. For Instagram, for China, you have tons of fake Instagrams, actually. And for SoundCloud, you have lots of music apps. But like the thing with the banding, the whole thing, and I'll come to the social media thing later, but I want to say this. The thing about the whole apps are banded, like if you are a local, if you're an international label, if you want to release songs, you often go to Spotify and SoundCloud, and then what else? Spotify, SoundCloud, and then Beatport, and then Apple Music, exactly. But if you're in China, so first you have to be able to go through the firewalls, and then a normal person wouldn't say, okay, I got this album, I found this one, like I worked my way through, let me set up a contract to contact them to get this album legally so that I can push it in China. Like, I don't think normal person will prefer that. So this is why there are so many apps that are extremely illegal, because everything is just free download. And but they're working on it. There are more and more labels internationally are talking with the local apps. But yes, with social media, for me, it's just, there's no like a special strategy. I just post things like on sync. So this time it's the peak time in Holland, and that is the peak time in China. I just post the exact same thing, except for sometimes it's in Chinese and it's in English. Yep.
Kaku, you have one of the widest reaches in social media on anyone in this panel. Do you have any strategies that have worked for you that these guys could learn from or other people could learn from?
Like I said, you know, this is all through just years of experience, and it was really hard for me to even build a fan base, you know, just being an Asian DJ, honestly, but like, it just takes time, you know, and you kind of have to figure out like your style. Like I realized that social media, it's all about branding, right? Like you have to like present yourself in a certain way that will attract followers to want to follow you. And so that's something that I really worked on the past year. So you can, if you really like look like back at my Instagram even, you can tell like it's become like less personal. Like I don't really like post a lot of things like that's really personal anymore, because I feel like, okay, what's the image that people want to perceive me as, you know? So I post mostly show pictures and just like the music I'm making or something like that, you know? And to let people kind of like into like what like the Kaku brand is, I'd say. Yeah, so that's something I've really like worked on, and it took me a while to get it. Like, you know, I realized that, okay, this is not your like personal Facebook page. This is your fan page. So what are your fans like trying to, you know, get from you, you know, like when they go on your page? So I'm still working on it, like I said, but I think it's something that I realized the past few years, yeah.
What about local PR and local media? Do you think that they're doing a lot to help young artists and regional artists get exposure?
So let's just talk about Taiwan now, because it's just easier. Basically, the media, and when it comes to like DJing or like electronic music, I think throughout Asia, it didn't always have like a positive persona, you know, like at least speaking on Taiwan, like the local government didn't really like support like dance music. They thought it was always like a bad thing because it's associated with drugs or whatever it may be. And so like now you're starting to see, like for example in Korea or like China, the government is starting to, you know, like I guess like reach out to like, you know, the dance music community a little bit more, putting a little more money into it, you know. So there is more publicity in dance music now throughout the Asian like regions. But yeah, it wasn't always like that. And
I mean, what do you think? Do you think that media and PR in Asia is doing enough for local artists? Or are they still focusing too much on international talent and bigging them up in Asia?
Yeah, I mean, of course, there's so much more money right now in the West. So of course, someone would want to focus on that. But with regard to individual social media accounts, I think the secret to a successful one is to curate an image that people look up to, or people, or when someone, when you see a DJ post on Instagram, you just be like, well, I wish I was living that life, you know? So when you sell them this alternate reality, you get this type of hardcore fan that just wants to be who you present yourself to be. And yeah, and the other thing is to also be personal on a level, right? It's just, you can't really force an image on yourself. So if you're not a funny guy, don't try to be. And if you're not, you know, naturally cool, just lots of artists have made bank just based on how weird they look to others, right? And yeah, I mean, there's no dead set strategy for social media.
Looking into the future, what are your plans for the next few years, and what would you like to happen, and what do you think could help you, or who could help you in your path?
Personally, I'd just like to see more large-scale events in Asia. And I think with the changing tastes of the Asian audience, they're not always looking to the West, right? They're consuming culture from within, which is only good news for local born and raised artists like me. And no, another thing I would love to do would be to pioneer different types of music, right? For people to get into, because if you're just gonna get in this industry and just make the same kind of stuff everyone else is doing with, you know, just your own sounds or presets, it's just counterproductive, I feel. Because, you know, all in all, like, even though it's an industry and people make money from it, large amounts of people still find a lot of joy and passion from just listening and sharing to music. And I think it's just artists' duty to contribute to that.
DJL, how about you? What are your future plans, and what do you want to see happen in the Chinese music market?
现在最希望就是希望在接下来几年有更多国外的一些唱片公司，还有一些什么好的音乐节，希望他们能更多的关注中国好的制作人和好的DJ。
Sorry. DJL said he wish in a few years you hope the international like record company and the music festival and can pay more attention at the Chinese artists.
然后还希望有更多的一些平台，还有一些经纪公司能够更多的帮助在中国的DJ。 然后另外之前我觉得在中国做DJ这个行业，然后基本是不会有经纪公司愿意去帮助一个DJ，投资一个DJ。 然后我觉得今年开始慢慢的有这个好的开始，我也刚刚签了一个中国的经纪公司，反正我希望以后能有更多的公司来支持这中国DJ，中国DJ走向世界这个梦想吧，谢谢。
It's a brand new industry in China for this, and DJL really wish the International like Music Association and for the EDM Association and support the Chinese local DJ more, because we need your support, we need your way to teach us how to achieve in this industry.
Kaku, what are your future plans, and how do you plan on infiltrating the West more? What are your plans to break into there?
So I'm fortunate that, like I said, I do speak English a little bit better than a lot of the artists and out in Asia, so I was able to network a lot better. So this year, like I said, I was able to play in Ibiza. I was also in Miami Music Week. So I think the barrier is breaking, you know? And I think, like, I'm happy to see that, obviously. And I guess my future plans, like, I have a lot of music coming out. Just that's what I've been working on the past year. And also going along with what DJL said, I would like to see a lot more, I guess, foreign groups, foreign companies invest into, you know, artists out of Asia. Because, like I said already, there is a lot of talent here. And I think people just need to put a little more effort into finding these artists, you know, and help develop them. I think that's something that I would like to see in the near future, you know.
Do you have any suggestions on how they could do that?
I mean, I don't know. I mean, IMS is a good start, right? I mean, we're all up here for a reason. And yeah, I don't know. I mean, I really do see that the industry is changing. So it's cool to see that happening, you know.
Minii, what are you working towards? And how do you hope that Korea scene can progress? What do you hope to see happening there?
We need more the. I hope people listening to the more the underground music, and is most people is don't understand is techno and house music, but I don't care that, cause I like it, and then I will make it in the underground scene in Seoul. So, and the photo feature, keep going to DJ and release the, my track and catch the your management, and yeah, that's it.
Chace, what's happening with you? What's on the pipeline? What's coming up?
All right, for me, it's always easy. So I always believe music is the key to everything. So, and that's also why I meet everybody, why everybody knows me, why everybody is interested in me, actually. So for me, I'll just keep on, keep up the good work and also work with more artists. And I also believe the music spreads itself. Good music spreads itself. So that also means I'll come to, well, I'll go to more countries and make more fans everywhere. And yeah, because I don't really set goals in this part of my life. I don't really set goals. I'm just very curious what's going to happen, actually.
One more question before I open the floor up. Something for each of you. What is the best and worst decision you have ever made with respect to your music career? I'm going to start over with you, Chace, so we go back this way. Best and worst decision.
I think the best decision for me is to not listening to my parents, actually. Because they were literally blocking me from producing. Because I definitely handing there, and that's definitely my best decision. And there's also a worse one, right?
Yeah, what's the worst decision you've made?
I think I always believe that men, like, I can always do better. So I think the worst decision, I wouldn't say it's a worst decision, but I just think I could have done better. Like, this could have happened earlier, actually.
I think it's happening pretty early for you.
I get that a lot, but thanks.
Minii, how about you?
A best decision, like, it's like, music is very good to me, like many inspiration to me, and the feeling too happy, and people is come to my show. That's really fun to me. And the best worst decision is nothing, I think.
Sorry, the worst decision?
Nothing.
Okay. You're lucky then. Kaku, how about you?
Best decision I made. Was actually going along with Chace, not listening to my parents, really. Because, I come from a very traditional family as well, like an Asian family as well, and they just didn't see, like, music or DJing as a career, you know? They were like, how's music going to put, you know, food on the table? So that's something that I really had to, like, even climb out of. You know, even, like, coming here and speaking in front of everybody here, like, it's a big step for me, really, and it's kind of like showing my parents, like, hey, like, you know, this really can happen, you know, if you work hard at it. So that's something that I'm really glad that I didn't give up on. And worst decision is almost quitting, like giving this all up. And I almost did, like 2 years ago, you know, like I even moved to Beijing, like got a 9-to-5 job, like hated it, hated every minute of it. And just, came back to music anyway. So I decided then that, hey, you know what, forget it. I'm just gonna go for it. And yeah, and I'm sitting here today, so.
DJL?
我觉得我最好的决定就是坚持了做了这一行，因为之前也碰到很多困难，然后当时身边的人很多人都放弃了DJ这个行业，然后我最终到现在坚持下来，然后但是还是最好的那个决定是选择当时在 Mist， 然后当时上海的音乐其实还没有 EDM 这个词语，然后 整个上海也当时也是很单一，也就是 mashup 啊 hip hop 的年代。然后后来，因为进入 Mist 之后，然后当时我们在做 EDM， 外面很多人说，哎，你这什么东西啊？你不是主流的，跟外面不一样，大家觉得不好。然后当时也是老板也支持了我，然后也就 外界有很多话说这个不好不好，但是老板支持我，我们就坚持下来。然后过了一年两年，然后后来有了EDM的成功，也使我是Mr更加好。
Do you remember all that?
I'm trying. Okay. Yes, the best decision I have ever made. He has ever made is say keep going to Korea. He never give up because in the same time, like in the old time, the same group of the DJs, most of them, because they face a lot of difficulty, like maybe food, maybe family, and they give up the job, and they give up for the aim, but he didn't give up, and also because of that, he choose to come to Miss 3 years ago, and Miss create a lot of opportunity for him, and during that time, at Miss, in the markets, it's true because we experience together. It's all about hip hop mashup, and there is no such word EDM in Shanghai. So it's a brand new thing. We do try a lot of stuff. We fail many times. We have a lot of artists, which is the companies really support us. And then we keep trying. We make the EDM like getting very big here, and which is the in the same time, Miss is getting very big, and you know everything is come together. So the best choice is choose Miss.
Last but not least.
I think my best decision ever was listening to my parents. And that was also my worst decision. Because when I was, you know, 17 and hot-headed and passionate, you know, I just discovered music as from a, you know, transitioning from a hobby to an actual job. So I told my parents, Mom, Dad, I want to quit high school and move to LA. And they said, don't be stupid. And then I said, you don't understand me. And, well, you know, looking back, if I were that boy and I moved to, you know, Los Angeles, I think I'd be a lot more unprepared than I am today, right? You know, if right now, if I meet someone I really look up to, you know, I'm prepared. Like, I have my stuff in order. I have, you know, credentials. But if I were just, you know, a teenager trying to get lucky in City of Angels, I would have just, you know, floundered and probably end up homeless or something. And I think also staying in Singapore has opened me to lots of, you know, opportunities, because I think creativity comes from limits, right? If you have all the tools in the world to make something perfect, you wouldn't even know where to start. But if you have limits, you're forced to be creative, and you know, that by definition is what creativity is. So staying in Singapore, I had a lot of limits, like, you know, not being physically able to shake hands and meet people. So I just resorted to the internet. And from there, that was, you know, so many things happened. I signed an EP. I've gotten support from all my favorite DJs and producers just by staying here. And yeah, I think that's why it's the best and the worst decisions I've made.
I think we're just about out of time. Do we have some time for questions for the audience, if we have any? Is there any questions from the audience? No? Okay. Thank you very much, guys.